Hi, thank you for tuning in to my virtual presentation. My name is Steve Bautista, and I am creating this presentation and recording it for the Fall 2020 Virtual Conference of the CCTE. I am happy to be able to share my research. I am sad that we are unable to be in beautiful San Diego together, where normally this fall conference is being held. But instead, we are all in a virtual space, and in a virtual space, we can be anywhere we want, I suppose. So for me, I have chosen the Jedi Council Chambers. Being a huge Star Wars nerd, I felt that would be most appropriate for this presentation. The instructions said have fun, so I will have fun. But I will also probably guarantee that this facade will be broken when the dog barks or the doorbell rings or somebody pops in to interrupt this recording. Anyways, thank you for watching this video and for your interest in the topic. This topic is dear to my heart. I'll share a little bit more about my own background and how this topic relates to my professional work. But first, I wanted to start with a short introductory video of this virtual presentation. Well, I hope you enjoyed that little creative presentation to my introduction of my study. And sadly, that's where the creativity ends. I have struggled with trying to figure out how I might present this study in 15 minutes in a creative fashion. And that's very difficult to do. Let me first give you a little bit of background on my title and my topic. The title of my presentation, as you can see here, is Hope for the Future: Understanding the Experience of Latinx Community College Students Who Are Aspiring to Become K-12 Teachers. This presentation, this study, is actually the topic of my dissertation, which I just completed and just defended. I think it's 68 days ago, so I am a freshly baked EDD. My dissertation is actually still in the editing process, but I have completed the final hurdle of my program at California State University, Fullerton. I serve in a community college role as a community college faculty member at Santa Ana College, where I am a counselor and program coordinator for our Center for Teacher Education. And I'm also vice president of ACCCTEP, which is the Association of California Community College Teacher Education Programs. So the presentation will be really an abbreviated version of my dissertation defense, which took probably an hour to go through. So I was trying to be creative and trying to find a way where I could share this information, but I know I'm not going to get through it completely. So I'm hoping to have maybe a larger discussion with maybe groups of folks who are interested in this topic to really dig deeper into my results and my findings. But I also wanted to share my recommendations to the field because I think they really speak to where we might be going and the future of teacher education. So a little bit about my background. I have a bachelor's degree in psychology, master's degree in clinical psychology, and now, thankfully, my doctorate from California State University Fullerton. So I'm a Titan all the way through. As I shared with you, I am the coordinator at Santa Ana College. I'm a counseling faculty member. I've been there for 20 years, so next month will be 20 years at Santa Ana College. But I also, in my capacity, have served locally, regionally, statewide, and nationally in different committees and areas in my work, trying to both develop and help support community college teacher education programs, develop model practices between community colleges and universities, and work to really promote the role and advocate for the role of community colleges in teacher preparation. But my most important role, the role that I enjoy the most, is that I'm a practitioner. I'm a counseling faculty member. So in that role, I had to work with students in their academic, career, personal planning through community college. I've worked with hundreds of students who begin college with the goal of becoming a teacher or decide to become a teacher, and we've worked with them closely through their journey through community college onto the university, and have many, many students who are now teachers in K-12 and preschool and higher ed, principals, administrators, and all across the board. So that has been my experience, and that's really the goal and the thing that's really inspired this study for me, is my work and my understanding and my working with those students. I've been journeying alongside them for so many years. So in terms of this conference, I really wanted to share some thought, things, food for thought, and has really brought to my mind in my work in this teacher preparation and thinking about the future of teacher education, which is obviously the context and the title of this conference, the theme of the conference. So I pose three different inquiry questions here. So one is, what can we learn, or how does the experience of community college Latinx students who are preparing to become teachers tell us about how we can better prepare minoritized populations to become K-12 teachers? The second one is about the role of hope, the significance of hope, and I'll talk about that as part of my research, and the development of critical consciousness. How do those two things shape the experience of future educators? And the third thing is, if we're thinking about radically changing, or the need to radically change K-12 schools to better fit the needs of the students that we're serving, how do we also redesign and radically redesign the preparation of those teachers? Do we need to focus on that? And can we focus on those issues and sticking points that really could help us and help teachers become the change agents they really want to become? So the background of my study is really kind of focusing, and the topic area is really focusing on three areas. And it's type of this, we all understand the teacher shortage. We all understand the lack of diversity in K-12 teachers in California. But I think it's examined as a part of a cyclical problem, a broken system that kind of perpetuates itself. So it starts at the top there with the graphic. We have this shortage of K-12 teachers and the lack of diversity of K-12 teachers in California. And those are exacerbated in areas that are served by high minoritized students, that are schools that are served by minoritized populations, low-income students. This shortage exacerbates the problems that are happening in K-12 schools, where we have minoritized populations, Latinx, Black, other students of color, whose achievement in K-12 is not the same as their peers. And so we understand the connection between the effectiveness of a teacher and the outcomes of students. The K-12, lack of K-12 achievement spills over into higher education. So we have the highest population of students in K-12 population are Latinx students. Their college going rates are lower than other student populations. And they're more likely to attend community college than a CSU or a UC. So when they arrive on our campuses and community colleges, we also see their outcomes also are not encouraging. They graduate at less frequent rates. They transfer at less frequent rates. So the community college system also then becomes a trap for students trying to achieve higher education. So with the lack of Latinx students who are able to complete community college, lack of them to be able to transfer, and lack of being able to become teachers, that again perpetuates the problem of them, you know, having enough, us having enough candidates to represent the population of California and the teaching force that we would want. So my study really looks at this bottom bubble here, right? This idea that we really need to, if we can get more Latinx students through community college, right, to transfer to the universities, then those students are more likely who want to become teachers can become teachers and then fill the need of the diversity of our K through 12 teaching population. So this is where my study is trying to address. I'm really trying to address the students who are in community college and what we can do as a community college system to get more students through to the universities so they can be actually graduate and become teachers. So again, my study really looked at two areas, the shortage of Latinx K through 12 teachers and the need for a community college to improve transfer outcomes for Latinx students. So my three research questions that I posed in this study were centered around the experience. And I really wanted to do a qualitative study as a counselor. I really wanted to understand the journey. Having talked with many, many students over my career, I really wanted to understand what were the points that supported them, what were the things that supported them, what were the challenges that they faced, and then really kind of understanding their whole experience navigating through community college to help me unpack what some of those, the things that we can do as practitioners to help those students. So the first research question was, how do Latinx community college transfer students aspiring to become K-12 teachers describe their experience in the community college teacher preparation programs? We'll talk about that in just a second. The second thing was about the people. How do counselors, professors, teachers, and other institutional agents and the support services offered by community colleges contribute to the success of these students? And then my third question was, very interested in some of the non-cognitive factors, non-academic factors, and one I'm really interested in is the role of hope. And so my third question was, what role does hope play in the experience of Latinx community college students aspiring to become K-12 teachers? So those are my three research questions. The importance of this research for me as a practitioner, this affects my everyday work. It affects the work that I do with students earlier today and later tomorrow and interacting with them and helping them become K through 12 teachers. But I think also it really would hopefully shine light on the experience of these students, which is really an understudied experience in the literature. And then it would also help us as practitioners of those who are engaged in this work to develop and implement strategies to support better outcomes for aspiring K-12 teachers. Also to really think deeply and think broadly about the impact of what we can do policy level, state level, to support community college teacher preparation programs, because right now we don't have that support. And then also inform colleges like my own and other colleges in the California community college system that are undergoing this guided pathways movement of how we might be able to structure the guided pathways framework to better support Latinx aspiring K-12 teachers. And then my last goal and importance of this research is really to shine light on this experience of their students, to tell their story. My conceptual framework was built around three theoretical foundations based in sociology and psychology. The first one is the social capital framework for the study of institutional agents by Stanton Salazar. So Stanton Salazar talks about individuals who work in schools or in other institutions, those that have capital, those that have power, those that have privilege, those who work with low income, or he called them low status individuals, and the ability of those of institutional agents to provide social capital to students who need those kinds of things, networking, material resources, connecting to resources, knowledge, all those things to support them to reach their goals, right? The other theory that I looked at is the validation theory by Laura Randone. And her studies really look at how faculty and their ability to academically and personally validate students, really particularly low-income, first-gen Latinx students, students of color, really helps them see themselves and being able to achieve their college education and achieve their goals. And then the third theory, the third area is the role of hope. And I use two hope theories that I'll talk about in depth a little bit longer. But what is the role of hope in that experience of students who are in community college? And wrapping this all around, as the graphic shows, is the exchange of social capital throughout this whole process, right? So within institutional agents, through the validation work of faculty, and this idea of hope, how does that create and sustain social capital for the students that need it? My research methods, I used an exploratory qualitative design. I used Cal State Fullerton as my setting. Not that I attended there, but for many, many reasons. One is that Cal State Fullerton is the number one transfer destination for California Community College students in the system. Actually, in over 40% of transfers that attend Cal State Fullerton identify next. And then in 2017, Cal State Fullerton actually had the second highest enrollment of students in their teacher credential programs. So they have a large number of students who attend Cal State Fullerton on the pathway of becoming a teacher. And then the last reason I use Cal State Fullerton is because I have a lot of colleagues and peers that could help me in this process. And they were very helpful in helping me develop the study and formulate the results of the study. So I sent out, with the help of my colleagues at Cal State Fullerton, their Center for Careers in Teaching, I was able to send out 250 invitations. I received 19 responses, or actually 29 responses to the survey, an invitation to participate. I then selected 15 individuals to invite for interviews. 12 actually were able to attend those interviews. So my sample size was 12. I actually had 6 female and 6 male students as part of my study. I wanted to overrepresent males in this study because they are actually underrepresented in the teaching force. So I really wanted to understand what their experience might be to maybe shine light on what we can do as teacher educators to promote and to support male Latinx students to become teachers. I also did a stratified sample. I really wanted to get a cross-section of students who are looking at different teaching interests, whether it's elementary, secondary, or special education. And then I also did, I wanted to go across different community colleges. So I look at students who maybe had different experiences from different California community colleges. And in fact, I chose students who were from 6 different community colleges. So 12 students total, 6 different community colleges, multiple points of interest in terms of their teaching, and then also multiple times and length of time in community college. So I had some students who were there for 1 or 2 years or about 2 years, some from, 2 to 5 years, and then some there were for 5 to 10 years. So I wanted to kind of get a sense of who the students were based on their experience. My qualitative findings. So my qualitative findings came out in 4 different categories. So I'm going to stop sharing this. I'm going to move to a poster presentation, which will help kind of summarize these findings a little bit easier for us to take a look at. So, so one of the questions that I ask students, I often ask students in there when I start working with them is, why did they decide to become a teacher? When they decided to become a teacher and why did they decide to become a teacher? And I asked that same question for this study as basically kind of a warm-up question, right, to kind of break the ice. But I really found when I unpacked the results and kind of looked at and did an analysis of the results of that question, that it was pretty significant in terms of understanding the experience of these students. So what I learned was that it was the experiences, that the K-12 experiences of the participants, including both positive and negative experiences and their interactions with teachers, really played a part in their decision to become a teacher. So for example, I had several participants who said that they were motivated and inspired by their teachers in high school or in elementary school by acts of kindness or acts of caring or things that they did that really showed that the participant that this is something that they wanna do in their own lives and as their own career. So there were lots of positive experiences that shaped that the experiences. For example, I had one participant who had an incarceration experience in high school, and it was a teacher who was the one that came and visited him in jail and helped him through that whole process. And that reaching out and reaching back to him really showed to him that teachers can have a positive influence in the lives of young people. I had another participant who shared that she struggled with English. And it wasn't until she had a first grade teacher who really sat with her during her lunch hours to help her explain and teach her English. And she remembered that, and that made her decide that she wanted to become a teacher as well. But there were also negative experiences. So I had participants who shared that it was because that they had negative experiences with teachers in K-12, that they had teachers who didn't care, they had teachers who actually demonstrated racist and bigoted things towards them, and they felt that as students. And so they decided that they wanted to become agents of change so that their other students wouldn't have to go through the same experience. I had students who came through the special education system in K-12, who had lots of negative experiences with teachers and decided to become a special ed teacher because of those experiences. So that really shaped their interest in becoming teachers. And I think that plays out across their whole experience, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. The second finding that I had was I asked students about their participation in teacher preparation programs. And interestingly enough, of the 12, six participated in teacher preparation programs in community colleges and six did not, right? And so that kind of speaks to a couple of different things. One is the disparity is that not all community colleges have teacher preparation programs, that we have some that have very robust and strong programs, and then we have other colleges that have nothing. And so that disparity was kind of played out in who I interviewed and the participants' experience. So of the six that participated in teacher preparation programs, they had a rich set of experiences that really showed that they were connected to other future teachers, they had peer groups, they had specialized counseling, they got to participate in pre-professional development, like field work or workshops or conferences that they fairly felt enriched their community college experience. Of the six that didn't participate, two of them went to community colleges that didn't have programs, right? And then three of them just chose not to, didn't know about them, or chose not to participate in their teacher preparation programs while they're in community college. And interestingly enough, of the six that did participate, the majority of those students were future elementary school teachers. Right, and they were embedded in majors like child development. And that makes sense because most community college teacher preparation programs are in those disciplines. And of the six who did not, interesting enough, the majority of them were men. Another interesting point was that most of those students were in secondary education preparation, that their goal was secondary education. So they were housed and their main points of contact were like English majors or math majors or music majors. And so that speaks to, I think, the disparity and maybe some of the structural issues that exist in teacher preparation, where we have some students who are closer to teacher education in child development or those types of programs. And then we have groups of students who are in other majors that aren't closely aligned, that maybe don't get access or are close enough to the resources to be able to access teacher preparation faculty and resources that are available to them at community colleges. So that was interesting. The students also who were in the six that did not, they also wished, as part of their experience, they would have had the same things that the ones who were in preparation programs did. Peers that were on this had the same goal, access to field work, and then specialized counseling. That the thing that they're really missing was the specialized counseling that they received, that they didn't receive when they were in community college. So the next area was the role of actually counselors and professors in the journey of these students. And every student came to my interview with names of professors who made an impact in their career and in their journey and in their transfer success. I mean, that was the question, is asking about their transfer success. So it's really important that we understand that you know, we understand that the teacher is the most important thing. We need to also understand that, and we prepare teachers at the lower division level, that teachers, professors are the most important thing, right? And what they described as teachers who were, the things that they described as having an influence were things like good teaching, right? Just that they were, had experiences that were part, they experienced good teaching. It wasn't just PowerPoint, it was interaction, it was engaging. The other thing that they talked about was they were empowered by high expectations, that these teachers had expected more from them, and they even challenged them to say, hey, you know, I think you can do better. Or I would encourage you to think more broadly about your career choice, and not just this, but also to do, maybe become a leader. Those things really impacted students' belief in themselves. Supporting them and connecting them to resources. Obviously, we had many students who talked about that it was the professors who pointed them to their teacher preparation programs and encouraged them to be a part of that or to do field work. Validating and affirming their career choices. So that's really important. I think when professors can understand or know that their students want to become teachers, they can provide that professional guidance and affirmation and validation to that work and saying, wow, you're really, I can see that this is a tool, this, you're really good at this skill, or giving them opportunities to share that skill with their classmates. Making a personal connection, sharing their own story was really important too, that professors who share their own story about becoming a teacher, understand their own background, understanding that they're not perfect and coming through this system, or understanding the pathway, that was, I think, also really validating for students. And then also representation. So the participants actually talked about having Latinx male professors, or teachers who spoke a second language, right? And having that representation in the classroom was significant to these Latinx students who are aspiring to become teachers, and they noticed that, and that was important to them. So it's really important that we have faculty at community colleges who have the backgrounds and understanding and the ability to work with students who want to become teachers. And the second piece of that was counselors. So the 11 of the 12 participants shared undoubtedly that part of their transfer success was the role of the counselor. Whether that was in a teacher preparation program or an EOPS counselor or another program, it was the counselor who really had the ability to help that student maybe navigate the complicated pathway. They helped them develop an educational plan. They helped them to understand the pathway of becoming a teacher, navigating through barriers that the student existed or encountered through their community college experience. So that experience, the role of the counselor is significant in the participation or the success of community college students. And what I also found was that it was the repeated interactions with the same counselors that was also really impactful. So in programs like EOPS or sometimes in teacher preparation programs, the student gets to see the same counselor over and over again, where they get to build that relationship and build that trust. And that trust and that relationship really helps students propel them to transfer. And then finally, this role of the role of hope in aspiring K-12 teachers. And so I share with you that I used two theories of hope in this process. One was the theory of hope theory, adult hope theory by C.R. Snyder. And Snyder's hope theory is a cognitive-based concept, and it's based on two different factors. One is, three different factors. One is goal, having a goal, the individual having a goal, and the ability to have agency thinking towards that goal. So motivation, desire, understanding the will, really, the willpower to want to reach that goal, right? So the factor of that aspect of it. And the other factor of that is pathways thinking. So the pathways thinking concept is really about knowing that if I encounter a barrier along the way, that I have the ability the ability and the strength to be able to navigate by that barrier, right? So it's agency thinking and pathways thinking. So high agency thinking or high motivation, high willpower versus the high pathways thinking or the high way power. Both those things lead to high hope students. And the literature on hope really shows in academic settings that high hope students have higher GPAs, are graduating, are reaching their goals, have less difficulty in navigating barriers, are more persistent, all those kinds of things that the data show, the research shows that high hope students are able to persist and navigate through challenging situations regardless of their backgrounds. The other theory that I looked at was critical hope by Jeff Duncan Andrade. So Duncan Andrade's theory is really this idea of critical hope and apply to educators. It's when students have educators in their lives who understand both the social and environmental conditions that the student is going to school in, right? And is willing to stand with students and help them navigate some of these difficult social, economic, environmental challenges that they face, and never give up on that student, right? So critical hope is this idea that as an educator, we're able to give our students critical hope when we, one, understand the landscape of K-12 education or higher education, and then are able to use our positions and our positions to be able to help help students navigate that, but also push some of those barriers out of the way. And he really has three areas of critical hope. One area is called material hope, when educators actually provide resources to students. And those resources could be material resources, money, could be food, it could be good teaching, it could be their time. It's an expression, giving something to the student to give them what they need inspires hope. The second thing is Socratic hope. So Socratic hope is this idea is that it's not just what you say, it's what you do. So we can tell students, you know, certain things that we believe in them, or we tell them that we, you know, can help them navigate barriers, or we can help them with challenges they have, or they say, I'm here for you. But if you don't back that up with action, that is called hokey hope, and that's not really the Socratic hope that they want. They want to see educators and teachers really standing, saying these things and standing for what they believe in and actually doing things and leading by example. And the third area is this audacious hope, the third aspect of critical hope. And audacious hope is this idea is that it's unrelenting. It never gives up. It's this idea is like no matter what barriers that we hit, and we hit together, that we're going to keep going on. And that's the audacious hope. When they see that audacious hope, it really provides the inspiration and the empowerment that students need in order to be successful, whether it's in K-12 or in higher education. So those are the two theories of hope that I looked at kind of unpacked and helped students kind of unpack and see where these kind of played out in the lives and the experiences of these students. So a couple of different, what did I learn? So critical hope and empowerment social capital, those things, when they're offered by institutional agents, have this ability to really transform, right? It has this ability to really transform the experience and understanding of students in really an important way. Because what I found that it helps does, it helps develop this a critical consciousness. So when educators can help young people or future teachers understand kind of the economic, social, environmental conditions to which education is now delivered and impact education and even understand it in their own lives, they really become empowered agents of change, right? So giving them the tools, giving them the understanding, being able to work with them to really unpack their own experiences in K-12 and identify how as a teacher they can help change the system really makes them very, very much impactful agents of change who want to change the system and then in turn inspire hope in others because they see themselves as role models and they see themselves as educators in the future returning to education to inspire individuals like themselves who they see themselves in K-12 to make it through, right? And there are many, many, many quotes that these students provided. And a lot of it was like, you know, I want to be a role model to my students. I want to be a mirror for them. I want to show them that if I can do this, they can too, right? And that's extremely powerful. Duncan Andrade, his metaphor for critical hope and students who are able to rise out of these social conditions, he wrote a paper. It's called Growing Roses Out of Concrete. And so the metaphor is this idea of concrete being the conditions and the roses being the students who are able to succeed and grow in that concrete. And the metaphor that he uses about being able to take students who are able to navigate the conditions and to create roses, if we take those roses and put them back into the same conditions, they're able to grow a rose garden, right? So if you think about that as being able to take students who experience harsh conditions, provide them with the hope, provide them with support, provide them with the structure that they need to be successful, to become roses themselves, they can then return as educators to grow the rose garden and hopefully smash the conditions, right, that exist that really hurt minoritized students. So that was the kind of the aha moment for me in terms of understanding the circle and the experience of these students and how it all kind of connects. So let me move to, I guess, some recommendations or implications. So at the policy level, I think not having an undergraduate pathway for students who want to become teachers really hurts them. And I think it also hurts the ability of community colleges to support those students. If we don't have certificates and degree pathways that we can align to students' goals, then they're floating out there. They're in child development, liberal arts, English, math. There's no program that we can piece together that can bring them together to form strongly united and connected teacher preparation programs. When they arrive on your campuses at the universities, speaking to those who are part of the universities, they may be in specific majors or in specific concentrations, but they're not like that at community college. And I think that hurts the system. I saw that in who accesses teacher preparation programs and who don't access teacher preparation programs. So I think we need to be thinking about that logically. How do we connect the transfer pathway with the university pathway leading to the credential? Because I think that will really help our system and our students get connected. And then if we can articulate those, the pathway, it would be way more meaningful and our ability to then help students, you know, get degrees. And in terms of practice, I think similarly focusing on the undergraduate preparation of K-12 teachers is really important, because if they're saying to us when they enter college, I want to become a teacher and I have a passion to change the system I came out of, but we don't do really anything with that until they reach the credential program because we're filling everything else with subject matter, then we've lost significant amount of time and we've lost significant points of engagement with those students. So I think we really need to, if we can, try to create a undergraduate preparation pathway that supports future educators along that pathway, including secondary education with all these things that they want, peer support, pre-professional support, pre-professional field work, all those kinds of things that make connection points for them along the way. And then we also need to have faculty, professors and counselors who are connected to this work and understand this work in a deep and meaningful way. One of the areas that I won't go into very deeply here is about the role of creating hope-generating systems. This is my model for that, that I hope to hopefully expand one day and share more deeply. But this hope, this model of hope-generating systems really includes agentes de esperanza, which are agents of hope that are inserted into the lives of young people or future teachers to support them on this journey. And then let me kind of break down to very specific recommendations that I would like to share. One is I really believe strongly about this connection to the undergraduate pathway. And I would like to see our state, if possible, develop a minor or a common preparation program for all future K-12 teachers. And I'm naming this one a minor in education preparation studies. Right, and this would go across elementary, secondary, and special education, and it would be combined lower division and upper division courses, and it would bridge the two. And those courses wouldn't be content courses. They wouldn't substitute for content courses, but these would be education courses. We've already started aligning ethnic studies courses and the other things that students need at the lower division level. We need to do that more with future teacher education students. So giving them coursework that's going to prepare them in the sociological, the psychological, and in other domains besides the content areas, in education learning theory, in critical race theory, and those things that we know that students need in order to be effective educators and not waiting to the fifth year. We also, in the second recommendation I have, is we really need to have standard community college teacher preparation programs at all California community colleges. It can't be sporadic. It can't be, you know, this school has, you know, this level of program, this school has this level of program, and this school has none, because there are future teachers that exist at all of the programs, at all the colleges. So if we instituted a pathway as a state, then that could then connect to community colleges developing formalized academic pathways with support that could support future educators. And then the third recommendation that I have out of my study is really the preparation of faculty and staff who work in community colleges. It's essential that we no longer can just be, you know, living off of the minimum qualifications of, you know, a master's degree in the discipline. We need to really have also professional preparation work in really helping students understand, helping teachers and professors have expertise in working with and addressing the needs of minoritized populations. So I'm going to stop sharing there. And that is my study in a nutshell. I would love to engage in conversation with you and with others about what you think about the results of my study. I'd love to hear your comments. I think there'll be an opportunity for maybe for us to dialogue about this, either virtually. So I'd love to hear your thoughts about the three things that I've recommended: an undergraduate preparation pathway, community college teacher preparation programs at all community colleges, as well as more professional preparation for community college faculty who have a heart for this work and are in it for the right reasons, but just may need the expertise and the training to help them work with the students who maybe we haven't really trained to work with. So again, if you have lasted this long through this presentation, I am extremely grateful. I thank you for listening. I thank you for taking the time. I thank you for the opportunity to share my research with you. Thank you.